Before we know where we're going, we must first learn where we came from. This is a brief history of the NALC and collective begging. In the early days of the Republic, the wages of our pioneer letter carriers were erratic at best. To make matters worse, by the 1830s, job security for letter carriers was lost to favoritism and partisanship, known as the spoils system. The spoils system rewarded party faithful with political appointments. This filtered down to letter carriers. Local post offices intertwined with the local political machines of the national party in power. Letter carriers acquired their jobs through partisan ties and lost them whenever there was a local or national change in party. A letter carrier was expected to be a campaign worker first and a letter carrier second. Hired only for political reasons, letter carriers generally were inclined to accept inadequate wages and poor working conditions. A serious movement to reform the spoils system did not develop until after the Civil War. The country's first civil service law, known as the Pendleton Act, was passed by Congress in 1883. Among other provisions, it specifically required letter carriers and post office clerks in every post office with 50 or more employees to take competitive exams to qualify for their jobs. For the first time since Andrew Jackson's administration, letter carriers were hired because they were qualified for their jobs, not because they were members of a certain political party. Furthermore, these same carriers could not legally be fired for political reasons. The struggle for an 8-hour day is a landmark in letter carrier history. It was an intense, nationwide movement involving an enormous number of workers in addition to letter carriers. Postal management vigorously opposed the movement. When an 8-hour bill for letter carriers was introduced in Congress in 1886, the Post Office Department harassed any and all active supporters. Some carriers who led the campaign were fired for minor infractions of work rules. Others were either transferred to less desirable routes, assigned routes far from their homes, given extra duties, or ordered to take vacations with no advance warning. Finally, in 1888, the 8-hour bill was passed. Letter carriers were now ready to organize a union. Their agenda? The formation of a national organization, petitioning Congress for an increase of carrier's salary, organizing a U.S. letter carriers mutual insurance company, the pensioning of carriers after continued service of years, and providing substitute carriers with a fixed salary during their period of probation. So when August Dahlman of Milwaukee called the convention to order on Thursday, August 29, 1889, in the meeting hall above Schaefer's Saloon, the NALC was born. In 1893, the Post Office Department initiated a program called the Spotter System. Hundreds of men hired by the department were assigned to travel secretly from city to city, literally to spy on carriers as they worked. In one case, a spotter was secretly watching a letter carrier on his route when the carrier happened to glance through a ground floor window of a patron's home. Seeing a woman and child lying on the floor, he immediately entered the house, found the two almost suffocated by a gas leak, and carried them out to safety. The spotter reported the event to his superiors and recommended the letter carrier's dismissal for deviation from his route. By the early 1900s, with no significant wage increase since 1887, the NALC began to lobby for an increase in wages. Congress would not budge on the issue. The NALC also lobbied hard to alleviate intolerable conditions for substitute carriers. Subs were required to report to the post office at least once every morning and often again at noon to see if they were needed that day. If they worked, they received a daily wage. If not, they received nothing. The NALC pleaded tirelessly with Congress to alleviate the distress of substitute carriers, but again, the pleas fell on deaf ears. In the 1900s, when letter carriers and other postal employees lobbied vigorously for a pay raise and other legislation, conservative leaders in Congress complained to the president. President Theodore Roosevelt, too, had been deluged with telegrams, letters, and petitions from postal workers and their supporters. So on January 31, 1902, he seized the offensive and issued the first of the famous gag orders. Roosevelt's executive order forbade all postal and federal employees, directly or indirectly, individually or through associations, to solicit members of Congress for wage increases or to try to influence the passage of any other legislation. In 1910, NALC President William E. Kelly urged passage of anti-gag legislation before the Senate Committee on Post Offices and Post Roads. Unfortunately, the President of the United States, William Howard Taft, participated in the campaign by publicly defending the gag rule. He stated that government employees are a privileged class, upon whose entry into government service it is entirely reasonable to impose conditions that should not be and ought not be imposed upon those who serve private employers. He did not say in what way the government employees were privileged under his administration. Trapped would perhaps have been a better and more honest word. Despite Taft's plea, the Congress of the United States decided the government's claim of special status had gone too far. On August 24, 1912, the Lloyd-La-Follette Act was enacted, rescinding the gag rule and ending 10 years of severe repression of letter carriers and other government workers. In March 1913, President Woodrow Wilson appointed Albert Burleson as Postmaster General. Burleson opposed all bills designed to establish pensions or annuities for postal employees. He believed that when a worker's job performance declined due to old age, he should be demoted or fired, no matter how many years the worker had labored for the department. The NALC fought hard, and on September 7, 1916, they obtained a passage of one of the most important laws to affect letter carriers then and now, the first Federal Employees Compensation Act. This landmark legislation provided that federal employees suffering work-related injuries would receive compensation for disability and death, as well as medical care. Also, during Burleson's regime, the Post Office Department was intrigued with a new movement called Taylorism. Scientific management, also called Taylorism after its founder, Frederick Winslow Taylor, was an attempt by management to apply the methods of science to the workplace. Its purpose was to completely control all decisions on the job and increase workers' total productivity and efficiency. The department called its program the Efficiency System. Department officials would single out the youngest, most physically fit carrier and use him as their average carrier. The officials would watch the carrier as he worked, measuring with a stopwatch each and every task performed both in the office and on the street. The carrier's pace measured in minutes became the standard by which all other carriers were expected to perform. Naturally, few letter carriers could easily maintain the pace, which forced them to speed up their efforts. Some even had to run instead of walking their routes to return to their stations by the required time. Carriers were not used to such strict control and pressure, and they found it cruel and dehumanizing. Carriers who could not maintain the accelerated pace were often punished with a reduction in wages, and some were dismissed. Many carriers even broke down under the mental and physical strain. In 1923, the NALC embarked on a major campaign to achieve a living wage for postal employees. The wages of letter carriers and other postal workers lagged further and further behind the wages of workers in the private sector. The campaign was effective. Congress passed a bill that increased wages by $300 a year. The NALC's success was short-lived. Despite widespread support for the bill, President Coolidge vetoed it, and the veto took a particularly damaging form. Congress received the veto message the same day it adjourned for the fall elections, making it impossible to override the president's action. In 1933, President Franklin D. Roosevelt cut government workers' pay by 15%. This cut, combined with a subsequent 9-day furlough for postal workers, reduced letter carriers' wages to their 1916 level. Hardest hit by the Depression were substitute carriers. City subs earned 65 cents an hour, and village subs earned as little as 50 cents an hour. Meager wages even before the 15% wage reduction. The steep decline in postal business forced the department to reduce deliveries and other services, making it impossible for subs to work enough hours to survive. 16 years without a pay raise. That was the situation letter carriers faced in 1941, and that was why they elected William C. Doherty. Doherty's leadership was dynamic and innovative. After a long, well-organized salary campaign, Doherty and the carriers were victorious. On July 6, 1945, President Harry S. Truman signed a bill giving letter carriers their first permanent pay increase in 20 years. Letter carriers were ecstatic over their legislative victories. By the end of the 1940s, the job of a letter carrier was beginning to compare favorably with jobs in the private industry. Letter carriers' anger and frustration over past congressional delays and inaction dissolved with each victory. April 18, 1950 was a turning point in the history of both letter carriers and the NALC. It was on that day that Postmaster Jesse Donaldson, without consulting the postal unions or Congress, issued an order that still affects letter carriers and the public today. He reduced residential mail deliveries to once a day and most business mail deliveries to twice a day. The infamous order of April 18th also permanently changed the job of letter carriers and the nature of their workday. Prior to this order, a letter carrier would return to the station after the morning delivery, take an hour or hour and a half break to eat and rest, and then sort mail before embarking on the second delivery. Suddenly, they found themselves eating their lunches on street curbs and next to or in collection boxes in all kinds of weather. Restroom facilities also became a major problem. On Labor Day 1952, Republican candidate Dwight D. Eisenhower addressed the NALC convention in New York City. In a spirit of friendliness, Eisenhower made this pledge: "If I have the responsibility of filling the highest post in the land, I'm going to have one ambition, that at the end of those 4 years, every working man and woman in the United States would say he was fair." 8 years later, after the Eisenhower era, letter carriers would never forget the friendly Ike who vetoed 4 pay raises. On January 17, 1962, President John F. Kennedy signed Executive Order 10988. Kennedy's order provided that a labor organization would gain national exclusive recognition once a majority of the employees in the appropriate bargaining unit chose the organization as its representative. The organization would then represent employees in grievance discussions and negotiate a national contract with management. Although bargaining would exclude wages, hours, and fringe benefits, the NALC had, at long last, gained the right to protect its members on the workroom floor. The NALC still could not bargain for wages, and by the mid-60s, their meager pay increases began to take their toll. Many carriers were struggling just to remain above the poverty line. Their wages were so low that in some states, carriers were eligible to receive food stamps, Medicaid, and other assistance designed for the poor. Carriers were tired of begging for better wages, and they were just as tired of the blatant inequality of power between the department and themselves. Fed up with the perception that they lacked muscle, carriers began to voice a growing militancy. The mushrooming militancy of the members frightened NALC President James Rademacher. In June 1969, Rademacher had asserted the right of letter carriers to strike and had, in New York in August, promised the city carriers he would lead a strike if Congress did not approve a fair wage increase. However, he feared that if a strike were called, only a few members would go out. So in December 1969, when Richard Nixon asked Rademacher to meet privately with him to forge a compromise on postal pay and postal reform, Rademacher agreed. When the results of the Rademacher-Nixon meeting became public, the leaders of other postal unions as well as members of Congress were outraged that they had been excluded. Letter carriers were furious. They were fed up with compromises and promises of better days to come. Rademacher had seriously misjudged the mood of many of his members in New York and, as events would prove, elsewhere throughout the nation. Letter carriers would not easily be appeased. At 12:01 a.m. March 18th, members of Branch 36 set up picket lines outside post offices, and although not all the members had voted, almost every letter carrier in Branch 36 stayed out. Immediately, over 25,000 postal clerks and drivers honored the picket lines, and later in the morning, when carriers in Brooklyn and in many parts of Long Island, northern New Jersey, and nearby Connecticut should have reported to work, many of their branches joined the strike. By March 23rd, the strikers numbered over 200,000 strong. After 8 days, it was over. First to go out and last to go back, New York City's letter carriers had shown a resolve and courage that would not be forgotten.
Postmaster General Blunt today lifted virtually all mail embargoes as the postal work stoppage drew to an end, even in New York where it all began and where federal troops were ordered in. Robert Shackney reports.
Go down two blocks, then make a right, then make a left. You'll be on trending when you make the left.
The troops tried to deliver mail this morning to New York offices, to big business, and to hospitals. But they didn't have to try very long. The strike was ending. Private, informal negotiations supposedly had produced a settlement, even as military mail delivery so tentatively began. It was announced at a New York news conference, a 12% pay increase, quicker raises, no penalties for local union leaders like Gus Johnson of the letter carriers.
As a consequence of the hardships we have all endured, and because of the absolute pledges given us by many of our friends in Congress, I hereby urge and direct members of Branch 36, National Association of Letter Carriers, to return to work. Thank you.
As a result of the strike, on April 2, 1970, letter carriers were given a 6% wage hike, retroactive to December 1969. In August, the Postal Reorganization Act of 1970 was enacted. Collective bargaining rights for postal employees, financial and operational independence for the post office, and a last legislative wage increase of 8% was implemented, retroactive to April 1970. In November, wage schedules compressed from 21 to 8 years. And last but not least, in July of 1971, the first national agreement was signed between the NALC and the United States Postal Service.